Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And I read, then Lord says, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the earth, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every crippled thing that cripples on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them, and God says to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the earth, over every living thing that moves on the earth. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, eternal King of glory, worship you here this morning. We thank you, Father, for another privilege to hear from your throne. Father, I ask, use me as a mouthpiece here this morning. Father, I do reduce you, increase. Father, touch every heart here. Father, and give every soul here testimony here this morning. God will look upon to you in everything. This we ask through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. You know, it's God talks about creating man and female in his own image. That means God is aiming to something. So I could remember during when we were going to secondary school then. So I have these other tutors around and teachers. And some will get to the classroom, they will ask you, what do you want to be in life? Some people will ask you, what do you want to be in life? What they are saying and what they're trying to point out, they want to really know what your aim is, your vision or your goal or your intention, what you love to be in life. And also, these are leaders that they are willing to sacrifice to bring something out of you or to nurture you to the point that they will have somebody to call like successor. That this one, if not sure, this is the leader this ought to be, and will bring out the leader in him. I want to talk, but here God is different, and I want to talk about, based on God's own purpose here, eternal legacy. I want to talk about eternal legacy here this morning. Every person, from his or her own perspective in life, everyone wants to be successful anywhere you are. Wherever you place yourself, whatever you do, you want to be successful in life. But first of all, what is success in life? When we talked about success, when you're looking to be successful, when your adventure, your purpose, and your aim in life, your perspective is to become successful. What is success? To my own little understanding, I see success can be defined here as the efficient and effective completion of an assigned task to the level of expectation of the one who gave the assignment. In other words, true success is the fulfillment of original purpose. That is the fulfillment of your original purpose. If I might say this, if I ask you to do anything, if you do it your way, to me it's not success. I want you to do it to the way I ask you to do it. So when we talked about internal legacy, there are things God is looking from us. There are some things God has deposited in us. And there are purpose and there are potential that is within us that God has put there, that God wants that to come out. If you look at our text, it talks about what you see. God says, let's create them in our own image, male and female. That means he wants something. And he says after that, he gives dominion to rule over everything. He says what? We shall rule. He now gives the authority to rule over everything. So success is not measured by what you have done compared to what others have done. That is not success. Rather, success is measured with what you have done compared to what you should have done. Not by comparing that you look at somebody, you say, okay, after I'm better than this. That is not success. You don't need to compare yourself to any other persons. You have to compare yourself. What am I supposed to do? Do I supposed to accomplish this? Is it what I'm supposed to accomplish in life compared to where you are? That is when you can look at yourself and say, I'm successful in life. Otherwise, you look at person, after I'm better than him, have BSc, doesn't have. No, that is not success, my brother or brethren, this morning. When we talk about success, what you're supposed to accomplish, if you have accomplished that, that is success. But if you accomplish other things other than what you're supposed to accomplish in life, that is not success. You are there wasting your time. When we talk about effectiveness of success, we're talking about you being ineffective in completing the real task in life. When we talk about internal legacy, God didn't bring you, he brings you to do some other transaction here, but at the end of it, God has a purpose, a potential that he placed within you, that you'll be able to make it to eternity. That is one of it, and the may of it. That is why when we talk, anytime you see any pastors or preacher talk to, he will definitely talk about our salvation. He can't preach and talk without salvation. That is the internal legacy we are talking about. Whatever you do here on it, it amounts to nothing except you fulfill that purpose, that potential that God has deposited around you. For instance, if I hired someone, or I give you a job, and or a cleaner, let's say a cleaner, and he comes to my house, and I ask that cleaner before I go on my errand, I says, if you do whatever you do, please, the dish there, clean that for me, or put it in order. Maybe I walked in, I look at this marble, I look at the ground, the towels, everywhere is polished, wax everywhere, he cleans it and put everything in order. And anybody that walks in that room or kitchen or anywhere there, you can tell, the cleaner really, really touched the ground. The floor is shining. It brings out the beauty of the towels and everything. But after everything, I walk towards the dish area, and it is the way I left. Do you see that as a success? In other way, he does a good thing, but that is not the right thing that I asked that person to do. So me that give the assignment, the person is a failure. So the completion of success that we talked about is to complete the correct assignment assigned to you and at the due time. One talk that was successful in life, there are time for everything, like the book of Ecclesiastes talk. There are time God has assigned to us. If you look at the time we have here on it, these are time that God has given to us to do what? To make our transaction on here on it before we pass on to eternity. And God will require that from you. Do you fulfill your potential here on it, or you pass through the wall, you let go of it, you don't do that which God has placed within you? In every world, find ourselves, we have to accomplish one thing or the other, and the measure of success. Here we have some examples. Industrial executive, if you look at them, their aim, they look at the number of products produced and sold. If you look at salesperson, the achievement or a series of sales goes and quarters. That is what they look at. If you look at politicians, they look forward to be elected into office. Leaders of religious congregation, they look forward to see soul being won, to win soul into the kingdom of God. That is their own success in life. Investors, they look at the level of return on the money they invest in some things. So in every area in life, athletes, you look at them, they look at the number of what to raise, won, and gold achieved in life. Army generals, they look at the number of what battle won in life. Surgeons, they look at the successful operations complete in life. We have teachers, they look at the number of students with high grades and points in average. Everywhere in life, you look at it. There are things and goals. There are potential there that everyone, every leader look up to. Like I says, then, during our school times, they ask, what do you want to be? Someone who says, I want to become a doctor, soldier, and on, you says. So those teachers and those people, they are looking at you. They want to bring out that you be. They want to now lead you and to train you to become that person's God, that protection that God has put within you. That is what they look forward to bring it out. And here in our text, God said, create and give dominion. That means God made every one of us who are leaders. He said we should rule dominion, to rule over everything. That tells me that God gives us, we have a potential to rule and to lead. So as a leader, it's another thing to, for you to be a leader and to let your people or people around you to look up to you. You know, when people look up to you, some, there are some leaders that makes them be, they become so powerful that they are my followers. People around me, they look up to me for arms, for anything. But the leader, for you to be a successful leader in life, to have a legacy, to say you leave a legacy, that means you have to produce other leaders. That is your task in life. You are not there to have people as a follower, to have a great congregation that follows you, but at the end of everything, you pass on to eternity without bringing out any potential in anybody or rise anyone to a leadership position. Who we are, who God has called us to be, He has called us to be a leader. He has called us to lead people. He has called us to bring out the potential in people. That is what God has placed within us. These are the responsibility and the potential that God has given to us. The Bible says He has given us dominion, authority, and to rule and to govern all that He creates over the earth. That tells me that we have something to do, to impart into people that are around us. That tells me that we are leaders. Everywhere you find yourself, whoever you are, you are a leader. And the leader you are, you are expected to bring something out of anyone under you, your followers. Look at Jesus Christ, example of Jesus Christ. He followed people. When He departed, what did He do? He knew quite okay, people that are with Him, He said they should continue that work. There are leaders that He expect them to do everything. And He entrusts into the hand of Peter His own church. He said, upon this rock I will build my church. What He's doing, He's willing to give the authority to Peter. He's willing to hand over to Peter. He's willing to see Peter, to bring out the potential in Peter, to see Peter rule and to govern all He's going to hand over to him. What about you, where you are this morning? Are you the type of leader that are selfish, that wish to see people looking, they look up to them for in need and everything? They will call upon you. If you are not there, nothing will happen. If you are not there, nothing will succeed. If you are not there, nothing will go on. Then you turn to become a failure. The internal legacy we are talking about. If you die and you happen to be a leader without bringing out the potential in anybody to become a leader that they are meant to be in life, the dream and your vision dies with you also. If you look at the leaders of our fellowship, Pastor Wema Michel, pass on to eternity. But the vision and the goal God put around him, the potential didn't die. Because he brought out the leaders in everyone. He placed everybody. And that is the vision of our fellowship today. You see couples, you see people rise and get the call of God. We send them there, believing that that vision, that goal, that potential that God has placed within them, that will come out. And we see the visions that we have is going on. So if you're a leader and you don't have visionaries that will carry on your vision, that will die. So anywhere you are, you're a leader. God has placed within you a potential of leader, which also you have to do what? See in order that are following you, to place in them and to bring out the potential in them for them to carry on as a visionaries your vision that you have in life. We've seen a lot of companies, a lot of organizations that fold up. Not because they don't have vision, not because they don't have good goal, but because they fail to trust other people. They fail to bring out the potential in others to hand over or to carry on the visions they have. The visionaries, they deny them of their what? Potentials. They refuse to give them the space and the opportunity to express that God has placed within them. Every one of us, a lot of people that talks about motivational speakers. When I talked about them, maybe some people don't like that. If you look at them, they are people that they call themselves leader. And what they do, they don't do, to me at times, they tell you you can be what you want to be. That is what I can't understand. There are potential God has placed within you. That is only what you can be. You cannot be what you want to be. If you see people that tries to be what they want to be, they turn to become a copy of the other person. And at the point that person stops, you discover they can't head to anywhere. They ends there. You can only be what God has made you to be. You can only succeed in the area and the potential that God has placed within you. You can only grow in that area. You can grow in any area you wish to be. You can't do anything you wish to do. God give us this ability, the protection, the power to govern everything that He has created. You know, any place or anywhere in life, that purpose is not understood, that place, abuse is inevitable. And what we're talking about is that precious time and energy, resources will definitely be wasted. But anywhere that you don't understand your task in life, anywhere that you don't know your potential in life, anywhere that you don't understand what God has called you to be, or the potential God has placed with you, so it's, abuse is inevitable in that area. And what you do, you will be there. You will waste your time. You waste your resources. You waste your energy trying to do what you are not, trying to become what you are not, trying to grow where God has not placed you to grow or to do anything. That is where you see people, individuals, they try by all means to become something they are not. That is where you see people, you see some musicians, you see them, when you listen to their music, you wonder, what is he talking about? Is this real music? That is not what they were, that is not the area or the potential God has given to them. You see some people, you say, why are you doing that? There is no success. In that area, what you discover, they will be there for a long while, but there will not be progress. They will not progress. They will not amount to anything. They will not grow to anything. So leader ought to have a lasting influence. I describe that as leader, the capacity to influence others that do what, that follow them, to inspire them to become what has God has called them to be. That is why preach. I will tell you every now and then that God has placed within you a potential, and that you can be, you can grow to be. And that is what God created everything. He gave us dominion. When Jesus Christ was going, he handed over to Peter. Why? Because he sees Peter, that Peter can do what? That governor the church. Or the New Testament church, he grew under Peter. He says that under Peter. That is what Jesus sees in him. Says he's a leader that can lead the church. He's a leader that can grow the church. Leader legacy, when we talked about that, to my own conviction that the ultimate purpose of leaders in business, religion, politics, education, sport, otherwise, is what? It's not the accomplishment of goal or the possession he has acquired, but the amount of people he imparts in life really matter. That is what I call leadership legacy. When we talked about leader, you've seen a lot of people after they pass on to eternity, no one to carry on their business. So if you're a leader and you're going to leave legacy in life, you should have visionaries. And visionaries are the followers. And these people, God has given them potential to also be a leader. And these people, you have to reveal to them, you have to lead and to train them to become a leader that God has called you to be. So a leader without legacy, that means you're not a leader, you're a failure. Maybe a leader that you look at it, you don't have successors. A leader that comes around you, you measure your leadership rules by what you've achieved or you have gathered or accumulated in life. You're a failure. A leader measures this what? Leadership role and legacy with the amount of people he has imparted in life or inspired to become a leader or to carry on his vision and his goal for life. So the rules of leader that we have to follow in life is not amount of money we gather. It's not amount of things we gather, but amount of mankind that we've affected in life, that we've trained, that we've imparted in life. That is what matters. And where you find yourself as a leader, you have a role to play, not just to lead them or to let those people to look up to you, but you have something to deposit in them. There are potential in them that you have to bring out. There are something God has put within them that is your duty to do what? To bring it out. If you're a leader, you carry on your vision alone by yourself, you produce and carry on everything and no visionary, that will definitely die. The origin of followers, when we talk about followers, look at here on our text, Genesis 1:26 says that. Then God says, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over everything that cripple on the earth. That is the origin. So God wants to, what God is saying in essence, God is a great human being and he clearly establishes purpose for them. That what he declares his options that, okay, they will rule over everything on earth. He understands. So when you have a leader, you have a followers, what it is that these people that are there, you have a role to do or to declare what they will be. And those people, they asked us during that time, during our secondary school, they were looking forward, okay, this is your addition. But when we get to a point, I could remember after my junior work, I want to go to our class that I do this. On the assembly ground during olden days, during our time, they call your name and you go to the class you belong. You don't go to where you want. Where you pass and you are fit to be, that is where you go. And during our own time, it's compulsory. They check your continuous assessment and everything, your record, whatever you pass, whatever you understand, you know best. That is where they place you. You don't go to like, now you choose what you want to do. They seize where you are good, the potential, the ability, where you have strength in. That is the area they send you to. On the assembly ground, they will call, you pass, you promote to this, you go to this during our own secondary school. So a lot of people, the first week of resorption, you don't see anybody around. At the assembly, there will be scanty, there will be a little people. Why? People are afraid. But if you trust yourself and you believe yourself, you will be there, will be there. The woke up will run away. They send us to science class, not what I intend to do. They look at me and see the potential. You are not meant for this. You are meant for this place. And that is what we are saying. As a leader, you should be able to design that. And now to bring out that potential in that person. And that is what God is doing. He look at us, he creates a follower, and he says, this man who've created female and male, he says what? We give them this role to lead and to control the fishes, everything that cripple on the earth. He says he has given us the ability to govern them. And as a leader you are, we are wherever we are. This is what we should look forward to. That anyone that God has placed within us, God has placed a potential within that person that we need to nurture, that we need to bring out, that we need to help to grow in that area. This is our responsibility as a leader. You are required to do what? To have principle to guide these people, to help them in their potential area, to grow, to bring what is in them out. This is the command of our Lord Jesus Christ. Everywhere you are, leader is not measured by your possession, not measured by your what you've acquired in life. In life is measured by the amount of people you inspire in life, you lead in life, you bless in life, you help to become that which they are meant to be in life. Not amount of people that you lead astray that are meant to look up to you for food, for everything. There is a say that it says you give a man a fish, you feed him for a day, but you teach a man how to fish, you feed him for the rest of his life. What that means is that if you look at this person, I can give you money to feed today. I've not bring out who you ought to be. But when you look at, you teach that person how to fish, you've given that person career, the potential that God has placed within that person. That person will live for the rest of his life, not asking for anything from you anymore. But always do what? Lead by himself and lead others. So where God plays us, he has given us that privilege, strong privilege to do what? To lead and to bring out people. If you are a type of leader that you follow, you are clever, you are stronger, you are intelligent, or you have this privilege, you use over others to bring out your selfish interests, then you are not a leader, you are a failure. Maybe you are that person here. You've seen people around you. You don't see what God plays around them. Or you see that these people ought to be under me. That is what we do in our nature of Africa. We don't allow people to grow to become whatever they are. What will subdue them, you put them where they are. These ones are to be here. I'm the only one that can make this money and give them this money. This is what they do. They refuse to bring out the protection God has placed within anyone. They lead us astray without plan, without anything organized. All you see, you remain there. I'm the one to give you. You can't lead. You don't understand how to lead. Can I tell you, God plays within everyone leadership role. You are there to lead one person or the other. God has placed somebody around you to lead. God has brought somebody closer to you to lead. Anywhere you are, and you fail to realize that, to bring out the protection of leadership in that person, then you become a failure in life. You have to bring out and see everyone around you as a leader and the potential in them to become what God has called them to be in life. You're not the only leader. If you happen to be the only leader, you pass on to eternity. What happens to the rest and the visions that God has for the entire world? When Jesus Christ was going, he left everything to Peter and the other apostles around. This is the only leader that he passed on to eternity, then all about salvation. Dies, no. And you see a lot of leaders, they refuse to bring out that in their followers because of what? Insecurity. They look at this, if I bring out the potential in him, they will look up to him. People will climb for him, like Saul and David. They climb for David, small boy, why? It's supposed to be me. Can I tell you, everything is not meant to roll around you. There are things that God has designed for you, and there are things that God has designed for your followers. What belongs to them, if you try to hide them, you turn to become a failure. Because as you end up, no one to carry on your vision in life. Everyone in life, there are things God has placed within you. There are things he has placed within around another person that God has brought closer to you. Your duty is to do what? To help them to grow and to become that God has made them to be. To discover that God has created them to be. You are meant to create other leaders. You are not meant to lead people failure in life. You are not meant to tell people how to accumulate only possession, but not to become a leader, which you've turned to become these days. That all we look up to is not how to rule and to do the will and the purpose and the protection that God has placed within us, only to accumulate something. When you talk about money, you see people gathers. When you talk about leaders, no one to lead. Because when they bring out, they say something, you'll be shocked. Is that how you're going to lead? When you say something, people will ignore you. What are you talking about? All I care for is wealth. Give me money and it's over. All I need is money. And what they look up to is that with money, everything can be solved. Can I tell you, it's a lie. Not everything. You can have money, still have problem and issue that you cannot solve. You can have money and have something you needed. You cannot do yourself. So ultimate goal of any true leader is to do what? To bring out that potential in his followers. Leaders are meant to create leaders. Leaders are not meant to lead people that look up to them. Leaders are not meant to lead people that are always in need. Leaders are not meant to lead people that cannot lead others. Leaders are meant to lead people and to bring out the leadership in everyone. And this principle is seen in the scripture. It continues manifesting itself with God encounter with humanity. God has placed within everyone the capacity to be a leader within the context of his or her own purpose in life. The book of Hebrews says something, Hebrews 5, 12 and 14, it says this was, say, for though by this time, you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principle of the oracle of God and have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a baby. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age. That is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to design both good and evil. What he's talking about is what? Followers are like students. Followers are meant to be taught. Followers are meant to be directed. Followers are meant to be instructed. So followers, he says, what you are, you're a follower, you are to be taught. When you understand, he says, is now you can go on as to become a leader. And the leader they expect from you is not just to become a leader. To become a leader that will teach and to bring out the leadership in others. We're taught of some things and what to do, when to school, we're taught of some things and what to do and how to grow and some things we understand in life. It says, now you got to a point that you have to pass that on again to another person because someone passed that on to you. For you to know what you know today, it could be your parents, it could be your teachers, it could be somebody, but they taught you to do that. Now it's your turn to do what? To teach others the same things, to become the leader they ought to be in life. Since you come to, you start with milk, but you come to a point that you take solid food, that tells that now you've gotten to a point to design what is good and what is bad. See, that again, you have to pass it on to other people. The writers of Hebrews is talking about what? There was a time you behave like a child. See, now you've not grown. So you have to let go of those childish activities and now behave matured. And now part of it is what? You teach those people under you, your followers, you expect them to become a leader also, not just to become a dependent that will always look up to you, that will always look up to you for needs, for help, and for you to provide for them. You have to release others to their potentials. You have to see the potential God has placed within others. You have to help them to come out and to become what God has made them to be. And he says, what? Go and make the disciple of all nations. Jesus obviously does what? He sees this authority, that this authority is not with me, gave out the permission and the authority to do what? To us. as the Great Commission. That is why it talks in the book of Mark. You look at it, 16:16, it talks about what? We go out to the utmost part of the world to do what? He says, we preach this gospel to as many that will agree, as many that will believe. Say, those ones will baptize. And he says, as many that reject, they will be condemned. So he has given this role to enable you to go out and tell them about this good news. As many that believe will do what? Will be saved. They will grow. To bring them to where they ought to be in life. To bring them to their leadership position. Every one of us, we should realize that the true nature of leader is what Jesus declared and he states in his philosophy of what leadership ought to be passed and transferred to others. Is you are not the only one that meant to become a leader or to be a leader for life. When you pass on to eternity, what happened? Who will come next? No one? So there are people placed around you that ought to become a leader. John 16:7 says this way, say, I tell you the truth, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the counselor, God's spirit, will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. What he says is going, and he needs someone that will lead you, the spirit to go. If Jesus go away, what it is that the apostles, the other disciples, they will now become a leader. They are to lead the church. They are to direct the people. They are to preach the gospel. They are to tell them the truth and to bring out the leadership in them. He has to go. One day or the other, every one of us will definitely go. And what would you leave as a legacy that you're a leader, once a parent or once an elder, once that rose somewhere or once that authority was given to, once that worked somewhere, what will be your legacy that day that will pass on to eternity? Maybe you look at leadership that you are there to provide for them alone or everyone to look up to you. That is not leadership. Not everyone to look up to you for arms. Not everyone to be there could not tell their right from their left. Leadership means you have to bring out the potential in that person. You have to train leaders. You are not only there to do what? To provide for them. To provide for them is good. But it's also good that you bring out the potential that God has deposited within them. That you need to bring out. And that is what Jesus did with Peter. He goes and he makes, he says, this on this rock I will do what? I will build my church. Leaders, you with a lot of people in the world, you see them. They despise the potential God has placed within people. Recently, we were at home during the election, and although the security called me, I didn't pick, and he called my wife, and my wife picked. So they called me when I got home, went there, and we see these people. They are there during this election or whatever they did. So this man dropped some good amount of money in that beer parlor for them to drink. Then they've not announced the results or whatsoever, and they were jubilating, they've won and this. And if you look at this man, they are taught, they've gotten alcoholic into their head that it got them intoxicated, they still fighting the security, beating and doing other sort of things. And the owner of the bar, when I got there, I said, why do they do this? And we're talking at the end of the day, although we said we'll go to a point. And we're talking. He cannot say in their presence, but when he will get back into the compound and he says something, he says, these are touts. Even their boss is also a tout. Talks to me. So what he's saying indirectly, these are human beings God has created. These are people God has placed one potential within them. These are people that God has purposed for their life. But their leader, dear, can't bring out their protection. I can't lead them to become a leader. Rather, he lead them to turn to become a tout that cannot produce anything rather than to do what? To destroy. These are people that cannot tell their right from their left. They can't design what is good and evil. Why? Because their leader failed. All he sees and all he understands is to accumulate money and possession. It's all I need. I have value if people can see me as chairman or whatsoever he claims to be. I have value if people can call me the president. I have value if they can see me as the executive. I have value if they can say I'm the manager of this. Yeah, it's good, but that is not attached to you. No, there is law of replacement. Table to turn, either you like it or not. If you refuse to leave that place, death will one day take you away from that place and another person will come. If you don't have leader, if you don't have successor, who will take over that position? Turns to become a failure. That is why you see in some areas, in some ministry, there's no plan. You see us growing. You see us moving ahead just with whatever it is, whatever comes, we take. But there's no plan. Why? Because there's no design for the leadership to control, to pass on the leader to others, will it create and what successors of what? Touts. Several good examples from this, we have this in the scripture. Look at Moses, whose successor was Joshua. Look at Paul, whose successor was what? Timothy, and a true son in faith. Jesus Christ, who entrusts the leadership of his what? Brand new church to Peter, another disciple, after he returns to the Father in heaven. Joshua served Moses as the right-hand man for 40 years. And when he got to a point that God wants to what? Take Moses, Moses was about to die, in the book of Deuteronomy 31, 14 to 15, when he wants to die, God asked Moses to come along with Joshua to the tent of meeting. And when God meet them and commissioned Joshua to be the next leader. At this point, not that Moses has already died or he has passed on to eternity, he was still alive. But he was willing to commission another leader that will succeed him. That's a successor. How many are you willing to see? I will give up this position. These people will recognize this man as the leader now, not me again. We attach, we look at that name leadership. We attach the value. We believe with that we have value with our name. Can I tell you, this position, we are not giving it out. We are giving it over. You want to transfer it to another person. And that is inevitable in life, whether you like it or not. If you refuse, that is where you fail. But if you are able to transfer the leadership position, then you pass in life. That means you train and the will of God, the eternal legacy will be there. It will be remembered forever. Deuteronomy says this, or it says, the Lord says to Moses, now the day of your death is near. Call Joshua and present yourselves at the tent of meeting where I will commission him. So Moses and Joshua came and present themselves at the tent of meeting. Then the Lord appears at the tent in a pillar of cloud, and the cloud stood at over the entrance of the tent. And that is where God commissioned him. Moses was still alive when God commissioned Joshua as his successor. And the children of Israel understand that, not that Moses is no longer in the role of leadership, as leadership, now turned to become what? Joshua turned to become the present leadership in his presence before God took him. And God says to Joshua, you know, if you have true leaders, he too, because God says to Joshua in the book of Joshua 1:5, there says what he says. Joshua, as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. That is a promise, because Moses fulfilled his destiny. He has a successor. He led Joshua, and God could ordain Joshua, commit Joshua as the next leader of Israelites. So Paul also expressed this. When he talked to, they expressed this leadership principle of transferring the and releasing the authority to Timothy. When he talks to Timothy in the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy 2:2, he says, and the things that I have, that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit this to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. What he's saying, he has given him the leadership where he is as a pastor. He says what? Also, look at people that are willing to learn and to listen. He said, commit this to them, that they can teach others also. In other words, that these people try to bring out the leadership role in others, you see. Lead them to what God has called them to be. The potential in them. He says, you bring it out. So not only you, the way I've done to you, I'm able to release the authority to you. I'm able to put you in position of leadership. He said, also, there are some that you should do. Put in place of authority, place of leadership. Everyone has responsibility to do what? To put people in place of authority. Jesus passed authority to Peter when he told him this, feed my sheep. The book of John 21, 15 and 17. Jesus restored Peter in this way. He says, so when they had eating breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, son of Jonah, do you love me more than this? And Peter says, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He says to him, feed my lamb. He says to him again, second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? He said to him, Peter, he says, Lord, you know that I love you. He says to him, tend my sheep. And 17 says what? He says to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he says to him the third time, do you love me? And he says to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus says to him, feed my sheep. What Jesus is doing here is giving up, is transferring what? Leadership to Peter. Feed my sheep. Shepherd my sheep. What he says, govern my people. Lead my people. This is the church, the leaders of the church of New Testament. God is giving him this leadership role. He's passing it over. Who in your life are you willing to pass over this leadership? Who will become your successor in life? Or you are there to carry on for everyone to look up to you? Democracy is only you that knows how to. Can I tell you? You will be shocked that your follower can be a better leader than you do. Everybody who says no, but that is the reality. Because the protection God has placed within you, you don't know. It's not for you to cover it. It's for you to bring it out. People around you, you're a leader that ought to do what? To bring out other leaders. You're not a leader to be there that after you, no one comes up. Look at Jesus Christ, pass on to eternity. To ravioli, go that, okay, we'll say after Jesus, no other person. But he says what? He transferred the leadership to Peter. He says what? Feed my sheep. What he's saying? Train my people. Lead them right. Don't lead them astray. After Jesus transferred this authority, also says, he says, that is when he says in the book of John 14:26, he says, but the counselor, the Holy Spirit, who the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. That is, anywhere you put leadership, there is role that God will govern on them because you bring out what it is in them. And if it's true leadership in the will of God, the Spirit of God will lead. True leadership in the path of God, that leadership will grow. Look at Jesus, he transferred to Peter and it worked in his way. But for that leaders that pass on, these successful leaders that pass on to their successors in life, Billy Graham, we talked about Billy Graham, pass on to what? Franklin as his successor in life. The Evangelist Association, his Evangelist Association, Nelson Mandela, passed on to the presidency of South Africa also to Thabo. A lot we've seen, the brilliant mathematicians and physician, Isaac Newton also, it says this way, he says, if I have seen further than certain other men, it is by standing upon the shoulder of the giant. What he's saying is that, if I have seen further than these other men, great men that it was before me, that means I stand on their own leadership. That is the people that bring out the leadership in me. That is the people that have helped me to get to where I am, standing on someone's shoulder. Anybody that is going to be your successor, that means that person is standing on your shoulder. It's going to carry on from where you stop. It's going to continue your vision. It's going to continue from that your leadership, where you stop. These are people that you've grown. Jesus was going, he passed on to Peter. Peter's not going to start afresh another Christ or another church or anything. He's going to carry on from where he stopped with Jesus Christ. It's your duty to bring a leader. And a leader is the one that will continue your visions. These are visionaries that will carry on your vision for life. You can pass on to eternity. Your vision will not pass on to eternity. Why? Because you are able to create and to see the protection in someone and to create a leader, to bring up a leader. If you don't, you pass on to eternity, the vision will die. If Jesus didn't transfer that authority that day, you will discover by now we're talking nothing about Christianity. If they hold on, that is so lame that day, you will not have anything any longer. We will be a pagan or a sinner today we're talking about. All about God, we pass on to eternity. We will have nothing to talk about God. And everywhere we find ourselves as a leader, it's very necessary and critical for us to be able to bring the effective leaders by doing what? By seeing the potential in order to create others and to bring others to what God has called them to be in life. It could be our children. It could be everything. Go remember then, my dad often and every now and then, he would want you to do everything. It looks as if he hates me or anything. Why do you do this? Why do you do this? He wants good out of me. And he has to train me. So as we close here this morning, the ultimate goal of leadership is to what? Train followers to become leaders and to lead people to independence. And then interdependence. This principle is seen throughout creation. God created everything to experience three phases of life. First one, that is dependence. Every living thing, whether it is the fruit whose the stem connect to the what? To the branches of the tree. Or woman, which the embryo, who is attached to his mother womb, see, begins life dependent. You depend on the source of that things to grow. So a leader you are, dependence are there. There are people, your follower, that depends on you. That depends on your wisdom. That depends on your teachings. That depends on your knowledge. The way you pass it on to them. That depends on that. That is the source. And second one, independence. So everything must mature to a stage at which it detaches itself from the source and express its individual and identity. So the fruit we talks about, the fruit of the tree will come to a point that it will get trapped. What does that do? It will fall for people to pick. And the children, the baby we're talking about in the embryo, it will come to a point that it turns to become a baby, and that will be attached. That is why we have baby after 9 months, and that turns to become baby. And also in the kingdom of God, when we're talking about leadership, these are people that they will grow to become independent on their own. They now have identity. They will now have their identity, and they will carry on their purpose for life. And the third phase here is interindependence. After independence, everything is responsible for contributing to the ongoing development and replacement of the species. So when it that becomes, that is what God has done and what who we are, we are leaders that God has created us, and we now bring on the other leadership, and that has got to a point that they need to pass on the leadership. And with this, they contribute to everything. And that is how Peter and the other disciples were able to bring out the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ to where it is today. And ourselves will carry it on. So what it is that they pass on the leadership right from ages to where we are. And it's our duty to continue in this, to pass on the leadership also to our children, to the babies around us, to anybody around us that we have ability to touch, to extend this leadership roles to them, to bring out the potential and what God has deposited within them. It's our responsibility, it's our duty to do that everywhere you find yourself. To become a successful leader, you have to achieve that. If you don't, then you turn to become a failure. A true leadership, you have to nurture people to come to where God has placed them to be, to come to realization that I am a leader. God has deposited this potential in me for me to do this work. Peter recognizes on, Paul recognizes on, Timothy also recognizes on, Joshua recognizes on. What about you? Are you willing today to bring out the leadership in others, or only about you? Without you, no other person. Everyone around you have to beg you for money to survive. They have to beg you for things to live. They have to depend on you. When you are not there, no one. If you are the type of leader that your presence, they need your presence to ever do anything in your organization or company, then you turn to become a failure. Why? Because you are not bringing out the leadership in them. You are not training them to become the leader they ought to be. A good leader, either your presence or not, they should be, the company should be able to function. The organization should be able to carry on their duty without your presence. But if you are not there and they cannot carry on what it means to be, then you turn to become a failure. Look at Jesus Christ. He passed on to eternity. In as much as he sent his comforter, the counselor, the Peter and other disciples were able to carry on the duty and pass on to us and where we are, and were willing also to carry on the duty and willing to see others to do what? To rise on to the call of God. That is why we have children church. We have teachers there that are willing there to bring out their potentials. And one day, you will be shocked. You will see one little boy you know here in this church standing on this pulpit preaching the will of God. That is the type of leadership we are looking onto. Pastor, when my mission passes on to eternity, the vision is still going on. We are willing to train leaders to carry on the vision. And we, the visionaries, we are willing to do his will. And we also are willing to see others under us to come up, to carry on the vision that he has lent to us. I will challenge you in your work, at home, and where you find yourself. It's our duty to train a leader, not to only accumulate possession, money, or wealth. In as much as you do that, let it be at the back of your mind that your responsibility is to train a leader in life. Our text talk about it. When God created everything, give us that role of leadership. And he also expects us to train a leader. That is why it says, multiply. You should train these people. Bring more. He expects you to grow in every way he places you. By training leaders in every aspect of life, we also expect everyone to train a leader. Let's have every about this morning, every eye close.